Our software spectrum has monoliths at one end and microservices at the other. What we're going to do now is we're going to talk about what a monolith is, what makes up a monolith, and what are the advantages and disadvantages to it. And then from there, we'll start looking at how we move from monoliths into microservices. So let's first take a look at the worst case scenario for a monolith. Now, of course, this does represent the worst case scenario. Many monoliths don't look like this, but there are some that do. So if you've built or seen one that looks like this, this may look familiar. But on the other hand, if you exist somewhere else on the spectrum with your monoliths, then your monoliths may look very different from this, and that's okay. But this is the worst case scenario. Basically, we call it the ball of mud. It's also often referred to as spaghetti code. Essentially, what we end up with in this case is there's no clear isolation in the application. If you look at this application, you can't divide it into subsections or anything like that. The entire application, everything depends on everything else. We have a lot of complex dependencies. Because of these complex dependencies, because of the lack of isolation, this is a very difficult application to understand, and an even harder application to modify. These are the types of applications that over time start to stagnate, and it becomes more and more expensive to make changes. And that's obviously a problem. So when we see this kind of application, when we have this monolithic ball of mud, we're tempted to clean it up. So how do we clean up the monolithic ball of mud so that it's not quite so ugly? So to clean up the ball of mud, well, we introduce isolation into the application. We divide the application along clear domain boundaries. So you can see that here. We've taken our ball of mud where everything depended on everything else, and we've said, okay, there is a particular section of the application that deals with orders. There is a section of the application that deals with customers. There's one for reservations. There's one for the menu. So these different sections of the application may exist as packages or libraries or some other manner of separation, but the point is that we have created very clear domain boundaries within our application. Libraries are a pretty common way to do this. So what are the characteristics of a monolith? Well, first off, a monolith is deployed as a single unit. That's kind of one of the key elements that makes it a monolith. You deploy only one of them. You deploy everything as a single unit. You may deploy that monolith multiple times, but within each instance of the monolith, everything is a single unit. They have a single shared database, typically, so they'll have usually a relational database, but it doesn't technically have to be, but it is usually a relational database, and they communicate usually with synchronous method calls. So this is a request-response scenario. You send a message, you expect a response immediately. There's often deep coupling between libraries and components. A lot of the time that's through the database. So you'll have different parts of your application all relying on the same data from the database. So they go to the database, they may do joins on the database, there may be views established, whatever. But they will all go to the database to get the data that they need. And that creates deep coupling. They have Big Bang style releases. So when you go to release this application, it's kind of an all or nothing. And what ends up happening is you'll get those situations where you have, okay, everybody, it's release day. So nobody check in any code because we're doing a release and we want to make sure nothing moves. So the world kind of stops while you're doing that release. Everybody focuses on that release. There's a lot of communication going on between teams about what's in the release and what isn't. There's often long cycle times. These can be weeks to months, sometimes longer. And then teams have to carefully synchronize features and releases. So again, in that Big Bang style release, you'll get a lot of the teams talking to each other saying, hey, I got my stuff in. Did you get your stuff in? And they're all trying to figure out whether all of the necessary pieces are going to be in that release before they release it. So how do we scale these monoliths? Well, multiple copies of the monolith are deployed. So typically we deploy several copies of the monolith. Each copy is fully independent. They usually don't communicate with each other. You don't know that there are multiple copies deployed, or at least each monolith doesn't know that there are other copies of itself deployed. They're fully independent. all of the dependency, all of the communication between monolith instances happens in the database. So the database provides consistency between the instances. Now, what are the advantages to this? It gives easy cross-module refactoring. So if you want to change something that is depended on by another module, you just do a refactor. You can often do that using your IDE tools, and that's completely fine. So that's very easy to do. It's also easy to maintain consistency. Again, the database acts as your consistency boundary. So as long as your database supports consistency, then your application will support it. And so this is very easy to maintain a consistent data set. You can always guarantee, for example, that if you write some data and then don't make any other modifications, you'll be able to read that data back. It's very easy to maintain consistency in a monolith. You have a single deployment process. So when you want to deploy, yes, you have this Big Bang style release, but you're only doing it once with one thing, and everybody knows how to do it, or at least a few people are going to know how to do it. You've only got one thing to monitor. So, you know, you just need to know, is your monolith running? I suppose you also need to know, is your database running? But from an application perspective, all you're monitoring is the monolith. So there's one thing to monitor, one approach to monitoring it. That's very, very simple. And it has a relatively simple scalability model. So again, the scalability model is just deploy more copies of it. And that's fine. So what are the disadvantages? It obviously has a lot of advantages. I mean, if I look at this, I say, hey, that all sounds really good. Why wouldn't I want that? Well, let's talk about what the trade-offs are. So we're limited by the maximum size of a single physical machine. Because of the nature of a monolith, as that monolith grows, it's going to occupy more memory, it's going to need more CPU, it's going to need, you know, more system resources. Eventually, it can grow to the point where it doesn't fit on the physical machine that you've got, and then you need to get a bigger physical machine. And as you continue to grow, you can eventually hit the point where you actually can't get a bigger physical machine. Or the other factor is big physical machines are often more expensive than small physical machines. So you'll end up with a cost issue with it as well. As you go to these bigger and bigger machines, they become more and more expensive. It also only scales as far as the database will allow. So yes, you can deploy multiple copies of the monolith. You can put them on multiple machines in order to continue to scale up. But often these are relying on a relational database, which probably only runs a single instance in order to maintain consistency. You might have multiple instances, but there's often a master-slave sort of scenario. And because of that, that master only scales to a certain point. Again, it's limited by the size of a single physical machine. And so you can hit that limit and then you have a problem. And if you're wondering whether that can happen, whether you're ever going to hit the situation where your database is going to run out of system resources, I can tell you it does. I've worked with clients that have hit that point where they're going, we cannot add any more load to this database because it will fall over and we can't get a bigger machine. So that does happen. Components must be scaled as a group. So even though certain components of your application may require less resources, it doesn't matter. You have to scale everything at the same time. And as a result, you may have unnecessary use of resources. The deep coupling that we talked about leads to inflexibility. Because you have everything depending on everything else, often through the database, it becomes very hard to modify things. You, for example, you want to change the structure of a table because you've realized that it's kind of inefficient and there's probably a better way to restructure it for a particular use case. The problem is there's a bunch of other things that are also accessing the data from that table. And so it becomes hard to make that modification because even though it may be more efficient for one thing, it may be less efficient for something else. And at the same time, you now have to track down all of those usages of that database table. So that it becomes inflexible in that sense. Development is typically slow because change is difficult due to the inflexibility and deep coupling. It means that change becomes difficult and build times start to become long. Serious failures in one component often bring down the whole monolith. So what'll end up happening is you'll have a particular failure, the monolith will go down, But then when one instance of the monolith goes down, it redistributes the load to the other instances, only they can't handle the load either. So now they start to collapse as well. This is called a cascading failure. So there are some advantages to a monolith, which we outlined, but there's disadvantages as well. And so when we build our applications, we have to think about that and we have to decide what are we going to balance? What are we going to trade in order to get the right advantages or disadvantages?